welcome to the sixth lecture in the series Signification in Buddhist and French Traditions. Today, we will discuss the dialectic of parole parle, the speech that is already spoken, that is given at the time when a child is born, and parole parlant, and the speech that is practiced, that is being used. So, there is a sort of a dialectic between the given and its use. When two persons use the same language or the same culture, they partly use the words with the same meanings and partly they extend their meanings. And this extension is so subtle that the speakers of language do not realize that the words are being used in different contexts with different semantic ranges. And this is why we say that we understand each other, because we are using the same language, and we do not understand each other because we are using the same language with slightly different semantic ranges. And this dialectic is the main source of the functioning of the language. Before Merleau-Ponty, Saussure had also talked about the same kind of phenomenon, and he had used the terms langue and parole. Langue is of the social order, the order that the order which is communal, which is social, which is in which all members of a community participate, and parole is the individual realization of the same. So, here is a quote. The French philosopher Maurice Merleau-Ponty believes that if language is an ensemble of differences, that means if with the help of words, we create differences to create different significations, it is by means of parole, the speech, the individual realization, that this differentiation is realized. Langue parole polarity of Saussure is then taken not only as social individual, but also and primarily as a dialectic between a given, a language that is instituted, presented to the speakers as a sort of a norm and a heritage, the parole parle, the speech that is already spoken, and the language in praxis with which the speaking subject expresses himself, the parole parlant, the speaking speech in a way. I mean, this is why these terms are, we keep the same terms in French, because there cannot be a proper translation. The main difference is a speech that is already there, in the which is a sort of a property of the society, which, in which all members of a community participate, and there is a dialectical interaction between this norm and the individual use of the same speech. Merleau-Ponty thus goes beyond the long parole polarity of Saussure. It brings him closer to the Buddhist theory of signification as a dynamic system of exclusions and negations, and also to the Abelardian and Condillacian propositions on language. These two phenomena we have already discussed in earlier lectures, that from the Buddhist point of view, language is a social phenomena as opposed to the natural phenomena of the Indian realists. And as a social phenomenon, it is a dynamic phenomenon. It is it depends upon the way the speakers, the writers, the thinkers use these words. To understand this dialectical praxis, that this practice of parole parle and parole parlant, the spoken speech and the speech in praxis, in practice, one should, according to Merleau-Ponty, consider this as a movement of transcendence that defines man as a creator of significations. Now, this is very important. It is to speak, this the process of speaking is a movement of transcendence. We use these words, but we also transcend these words. There is a, that means we go beyond. That defines man as a creator of significations. This is how we a man is not only a consumer of signification, that is, he uses the words not only with the meanings that which are already there, but also with the way he perceives the relationship between the words and the things that he is discussing. The world of parole parle is present like a horizon, that it is like a horizon which is not a fixed limit which is there, but you can never really achieve it. But according to Merlleau-Ponty, this horizon enables an individual to orient himself, to situate things by situating himself with rapport to them. So, this horizon enables a human being, a speaker, to situate himself vis-a-vis the things. That means, to be able to correlate words with the objects, with the things, with the signified, the relationship between the signifier, the word, and the signified, the thing. It remains always in the state of transcendence, but this transcendence is not of the usual transcendental order. So, this is very important. It is, there is something to transcend. This, there is something real, the parole parle to transcend, to be dialectically related with. Now, this is quite different from the Husserlian and even Heideggerian understanding, the German understanding of transcendence, where that transcendence is pure. There is no real given that is to be transcended. So, in the both in the Buddhist tradition and in the French tradition, beginning with Abelard and Condillac and now Merleau-Ponty, there is always a point of departure in the sensuous world. This is why the question of transcendence arises, and this is why also the question of the creator of significations, that human being, the speakers of a in a given community, not only consume signification, but they also create. And this is this dialectic of parole parle and parole parlant is the process through which new significations are created. The parole parle represents certain ensembles of complex ideas whose combinations are mediated across their interaction with those of parole parlant. The same thing, that there is a dialectical interaction between parole parle and parole parlant. It is due to the significative intention that is based on the excess of what one wants to say over what has already been said. The speech act invariably leads to the surpassing of signification by the signifier. In other words, there is the tendency is to be able to say something more than what has been already said by the same words, that we use the words partly with the significance that is already there, which is attached by all speakers of the community, and partly you go beyond. There is a, that is what is called an excess of what one wants to say. What you want to say, something which has not been said before, but you use the words which are already there. So, this is why, this is very important statement of Merleau-Ponty. For Merleau-Ponty, all expression is provisionally fixed. You see, it is a, I mean, all expression, all speech is provisionally fixed. Provisional, for the signified, like the signifier, is inscribed in the indefinite movement of differentiation and articulation that characterizes the thinking thought, the pensée pensante, the words, the langue. It's a provisional, this fixed, but it is this fixation, it is only provisional. You see, you have to go beyond that. For the signified, like the signifier, is inscribed in the indefinite movement of differentiation and articulation that characterizes the thinking thought, the pensée pensante, this is a thought in praxis, and the speaking speech, the speech in praxis, the parole parlant. You see, this also goes back to the French philosopher Descartes, who defines human being as thinking beings. You see, he says cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. So the human beings are beings who think. They are different from, say, animals. You know, human beings are defined, man is a rational animal, man is a political animal, man is a social animal, things like that. Now, Descartes defines man as a thinking being. The human beings are the beings who think, you see, who not only consume, but who also create. We must realize that langue and parole are conceptual constructs. In a way, both langue and parole are conceptual constructs. They are not fixed. You cannot, in a way, transcribe either langue or parole, because they are dynamic. They are always changing. They are being used, and in the process of being used, it is the language as such. The use of language is a dynamic process. Language, langue, is what is supposed to belong to the society. That is its definition, to the community, to a group, which by definition is heterogeneous. It also must be remembered that when we refer to society, to the community, to the group, it is not a homogeneous affair, because every group includes so many beings, differences of age, differences of gender, differences of professions, and they do not always, even though they belong to the same linguistic community, they do not always use the words with the same meanings, or even pronounce the words with the same phonetic realizations. It is not a totality due to a mathematical addition of the paroles of every member of the group. It is not even you cannot say 500 persons in the speaking and you add 1 by 1 500, and there is no such thing as a kind of average. At best it is an approximation. We can discuss of langue is an approximation. You see, it is something like that, but it is not exactly like that. It is a given, a horizon, which, as Merleau-Ponty says, enables us to situate oneself vis-a-vis the universe one is a part of. Parole, on the other hand, is also a reality that is in constant flux, as the speaking subject is not a static entity. The parole parlant derives its sum of significations from a series of existential experiences, which are always at variance with the so-called norms of the law. You see, here the question of parole parlant, the question of the individual, is also directly related with that each person's existential experiences. You see, and they are always in constant flux. You see, this is this theory of Merleau-Ponty corresponds very well with the Buddhist understanding of linguistic phenomena. Now, earlier in the 12th century, Abelard had stated that communication takes place between two thinking beings. The acquisition of language is a process that both conscious and unconscious. The subject is neither all important, nor it is submerged in the so-called langue of the culture. An individual is a member of a group, but he is not dissolved in the group. See, he is belonging to a group, so he uses language, culture, religion of the group. It is a kind of a approximation, but at the same time, since he is not submerged in it, he keeps his individual identity, and that individual identity is the aspect of parole. The subject is neither all important, nor it is submerged in the so-called langue of the culture. The acquisition of language, and consequently of knowledge, you see, language and knowledge here are they correspond very well, follows not only the path of normal communal experiences, but also of individual existential exercises or assertions. That means an individual, on the one hand, follows the normal communal experiences of the group, but at the same time also of individual existential assertions. So he is an existential being. He has his being, which is not submerged with the beings of all the members of the group. The world before us must not only be apprehended, but it must also be interpreted. You see, human beings not only apprehend, they don't only learn what is given, but at the same, all the time, they are always perceiving the reality in a certain manner and they are always interpreting it. There are two processes simultaneously at work, the process of acquisition and the process of appropriation. The individual, the subject of the parole parlance, is a member of a community, a group, but this individual never loses his individuality. When two thinking beings use similar words to express their thoughts, more often than not, they do not accompany them with the same conceptual constructs, or as Condillac would have it, with the same ensemble of partial ideas. That when we use the words of a, when two members of a given community use the same words, as they are also thinking beings, they not only see things, but they also perceive things. They not only learn the signification of things, but they also interpret them. And in this process, in this dialectical dialectic process, new significations are created. The speaking subject, according to Merlleau-Ponty, is not only a consumer of significations already established in the praxis of communication, in this use of language, he also participates in creating new significations. In a way, in this praxis, signification is both absent and present. The significative intention tries to go beyond, to absorb what is present, to reveal what is absent. It leads to a conceptual negotiation between the two poles of the ambiguous linguistic spectrum. So this is very important. So, the signification of words, in a way, it is quite ambiguous. We generally, for example, Abelard had said, you see, the word leads to the idea, idea to the thing. See, when we use a word, we do not refer to a thing, to an object, but to the concept of that object, to the idea of that object. And since idea and concepts are quite ambiguous categories, so this praxis is quite, in one sense, it is ambiguous. But this ambiguity is the main source of creativity. When things are fixed, when the meanings are fixed, there no creativity is possible. You have to say the same thing with the same meaning. But since the words are ambiguous, and ambiguous from the point of view of their semantic ranges, and moreover, this ambiguity is inexhaustible, you can continue to create. You see, what is truth, what is justice, what is beauty, these are concepts, and their semantic ranges, what they signify, what are their conceptual constructs, are ambiguous. Their semantic ranges have a horizon around them, have a kind of a halo around them, but they are not fixed, and because they are not fixed, the semantic ranges can be extended. The people, the speakers of the language, the thinkers who articulate that language can continue to use these words and concepts with slightly different semantic ranges within the process of articulation and speaking. To acquire a language, says Merlleau-Ponty, is to enter into the whole, to take charge of the movement of differentiation and articulation. And this enterprise continues indefinitely. You see, in now this is where we can talk about modern linguistics. For example, when Chomsky talks about the acquisition of language, he talks about only grammar. A child by the age of 7-8 acquires the phonology of the language, how the word should be pronounced, and the grammar of the language. But this aspect is fixed. This is not ambiguous. Okay? But language, how you acquire language, you see, is how to use this language, how to constitute discourses. With the help of grammatical constructs, we cannot constitute discourses. A grammatical construct leads us to a grammatical discourse. But a conceptual construct leads us to a conceptual discourse, and language, the function of language is not only to use the word, but to say something that means something. To acquire a language, says Merleau-Ponty, is to enter into the whole, to take charge of the movement of differentiation and articulation, and this enterprise continues indefinitely. You see, the, for example, our sentences, our enunciations, not only should they should be grammatically correct, but they should also be conceptually correct, and that is the level of discourse. Both the Buddhist tradition and the French tradition concentrate on the conceptual aspect or the conceptual discourse of the language, and not on the formal entities of the language of phonology and morphology and syntax. As such, says Merleau-Ponty, the speaking subject is not only supposed to have acquired the language when he has mastered the basic structures of language, the Chomskyan acquisition, but it continues to be acquired and appropriated as the speaking subject moves beyond the so-called grammatical constructs to logical and conceptual constructs in the domain of signification. You see, this is the most important part, that and this is the fundamental notion that is common to both the Buddhist tradition and the French tradition, beginning with Abelard and Condillac and now Merleau-Ponty, that the language is primarily, there should be grammar, there should be pronunciation, there is phonology, morphology, syntax, they are all important, but these are only tools of the language. This is not the end of the language. With these tools, we constitute conceptual constructs, we constitute conceptual discourses. You see, it is the thinking beings who use the language, and it is the thought that is the aim of the speaking faculty. The expressive operation is expressive only in the sense that it is differentiative, the distinction that are made by means of language. Significance is always negative and differentiative, but this differentiation does not have a definite form. In the history of signification, there are two extreme positions. Either the word has no significance at all, as for the radical nominalists of the 14th century, or the word is primordial, its significance is eternal, as for the Indian realists of the Nyaya Visheshika and Mimamsa traditions. The French tradition of conceptualism, since Abelard, negotiates a middle path. There is a certain significance of the parole parler, however ambiguous it may be. The speaking subject does not merely follow the rules of the game already laid down. Simultaneously, he acts as a speaking and a thinking subject, and depending upon specific existential situations, he conforms to what is expected of him or creates new significations in the communicative space of dialectical interaction. There is, as such, no a priori transcendental thought at the disposal of the speaker. The emerging significations interact with those which are already there. Thank you.